I can focus this time a bit more on the details of how the computations are performed, and this time I'm going to focus on coordinates at the beginning, projections first, datums then. Then we will explain how the computations for geodistance and geodirection, etc., are performed, given some details of the ellipsoidal geometry. I will show a couple of examples of how the low-level computation, the low-level framework for geographics has been improved, showing a couple of things that now you'll see work better. Then I will talk about our geophysics functions, and I will conclude with some future directions in geocomputation in the Wolfram language. The Earth's surface is curved, which means that every time that we draw a flat map, there will be distortion, no matter what. The mapping from the coordinates latitude and longitude on the Earth to the XY coordinates on the map is what we call a projection, and basically we have the full freedom of choosing any mapping from R2 to R2. So we have to choose something that helps us in visualizing. For example, you might think that if we choose equirectangular, it should be fine, but if you go very up north, and this place is in Alaska, you'll see that this is a standard Mercator map, and you see how, I don't know, these two streets cross in a 90 degrees angle, while here in the same equirectangular map, this is all very distorted in terms of angles. If we go to a Mercator projection, like this one, but we go to the whole world, now we have different problems. For example, the Mercator projection, which is this, is the standard view that the Google Maps, etc., offer us. We see that, for example, Greenland is really large. If we just divide the area of Africa divided by the area of Greenland, it's 14, while here they look like the same, right? Here, this is the rectangular projection, and it looks better, but still, it's not correct. Something that the users have complained sometimes, and it has been reported as a bug, but it's not, is that when you draw the map and you try to look at the coordinates, so I'm showing here the frame ticks, a point like this, I mean, it has latitude which is beyond 100. But this is not latitude, this is a projected coordinate, and precisely this is what the projection is doing. It's converting from this coordinate to those coordinates. Right? Something that helps in here, and I want to point it as if you click and then you click period, you enable dynamics, yes. So let me put this bigger. Here, you see, we get this little screen, box showing the coordinates, for example, here somewhere, latitude 79, and then it's telling you also in the last line the Y coordinate, 135, right? So we have to distinguish these coordinates carefully. Okay. The collection of projections in the Wolfram language keeps growing. We have now more than 150 for ellipsoidal, for spherical models. And there are many ways in which we can classify. Geoprojection data can show all these classes of projections, and there are many different things which we can use to classify. Say, we have projections that preserve area, for example. We have all of these. And now, the Mulvide projection is one of these. And here. So if we draw the same map as before with the Mulvide projection, now you see we get Greenland with the proper size with respect to Africa. We have conformal projections, which are those that preserve properly angles. They are going to distort sizes, but yeah, they will preserve angles, and Mercator is one of those. We have cylindrical projections, many other things. Okay. Then you can query the classes that a given projection belongs to. For example, say the Albers projection. So it's conic, it's equal area, and then it does not belong to these other projection classes. Now, projections have parameters. That's important as well. So these are the default values for the of the parameters for the Albers projection. So we have the centering, the grid origin, reference model, and standard parallels. So it's a conic projection because the method of projection is based essentially by having a cone and then cutting the Earth and then projecting from the surface of the Earth to the cone in some way. Not perspective, but some other way. Let me explain what these two parameters mean. So by default, the Albers projection would show us the world like this. Now, if we choose a different centering and a different grid origin, you see that here, the centering, the 0, 0, was here. So that's the 0, 0 in latitude, and that's the 0, 0 in projected coordinates as well. Now, we can change the centering to 50 latitude 100, which is that point, and we can say that we want that to be the point 1, 1 in the map. So now that's going to appear as 1, 1 in the map. So there is a fixed translation to make that point any value we want. This is very much used in geodesy, because map making, because they tend to avoid negative numbers. So they want to have the center with some large number that guarantees that all the points to the left and to the south are going to have also positive numbers. Now, what are these standard parallels? Well, these standard parallels are basically the latitudes of the two circles in which the cone is crossing the Earth. Right? So by default, we have 0 and 60, and we have this kind of aperture for the cone. If we change it to minus 10 and 20, now we have that. And in fact, if these two numbers are equal but negative sign of each other, then this would be a cone which is completely vertical, so it comes back to a cylinder. And that's why this is getting closer to being cylindrical. Okay, so that's the standard parameter. And then finally, the reference model is a global scale of the map. So these coordinates are basically of order 1, because we put a 1 here. If this was a 10, then all these numbers will be multiplied by 10. So that allows you to control the coordinates in the map. This is just an example of how many projections we have. This code will produce this graticule of lines. So we have, in red, we have the parallels. In blue, we have the meridians. And this is a collage for the 150-something projections we have. And you see the many different shapes that this graticule can take. In the future, I hope very soon, we will have other types of projections. We will have oblique projections, which means the axis which we are using, for example, in the cylinder or in the cone, can be oriented in any direction. For example, what I did here is moving Champagne vertically until it gets to the North Pole. So now Champagne is there. So now in the process, the North Pole came down this way, the South Pole went up this way, so that's why we see this map. So this is an oblique projection, and this is something we can do for every projection. These are the so-called interrupted projections, which means we cut the Earth in regions, and then we project each region with different set of parameters, and we do it in a way that fits nicely. So we have to choose the parameters properly, the parameters, the centering, and the grid origin that I was introducing before. And then finally, another thing that we want to introduce are functions that are analyzing the distortion introduced by the projection in a given region. So this is the Isle of Madagascar, and this is distortion in angles, in some measure that I'm not going to explain now. But we will have a function called geodistortion, geoarea distortion, geodistance distortion, and geodirection distortion. Okay, so that's all about projections. I introduced latitude and longitude, but I didn't say what they meant. And if you want to compute something precisely, you need to know precisely what it means. So I'm going to explain what latitude and longitude mean in this context. So take an Earth with this semi-axis in meters. So that would be semi-major axis of 100 kilometers and 90 kilometers. And I'm taking exactly the same elevation profile that of the Earth, but it just looks very distorted simply because I've changed this. And yes, the eccentricity is also very high. You see, it's something like a part in 5 instead of a part in 300. Now, how do we introduce latitude and longitude here? That's the point. How do we assign latitude and longitude to a point on the surface of this thing? Well, we have to make some choices. First, we have to choose an ellipsoid that approximates the Earth. So I'm going to introduce an ellipsoid here with these values of the semi-major of the three axes of the ellipsoid. It's an ellipsoid of revolution, so these two are equal. And so that's the ellipsoid. I'm also drawing the axis because it's an ellipsoid of revolution. It has an axis. So I put it here. And notice that I'm also rotating it with some angle and translating it so that I approximate the Earth as in the region I'm interested in or whatever. So there is freedom here. Actually, there are 6 parameters, 3 for the rotation, the 3 angles, the 3 Euler angles of the rotation, and 3 for a translation of the center of the Earth. So we have that. And now we still cannot draw lines here because we don't know where to start. So we need to choose a prime meridian. And we also need to choose what is north and what is south. So we need some sort of oriented prime meridian, which is this thing here. So this is the prime meridian now, and we have it's oriented, so this arrow, it's pointing north. Okay, so now we can draw lines on the ellipsoid, but we still cannot say what the latitude and a longitude is for a given point on the Earth, because there is an additional problem here, and this is important as well. So take the sphere and say, imagine that this is the point on a mountain. What is the latitude and longitude of that point if we have chosen this as the ellipsoid? Well, in this case, it's clear. There is no question. But if we have some sort of ellipsoid like that, then we have problems because this line and this line do not coincide. Notice this angle of 47.2 degrees is keeping being the same, right? So we have this is the line which is tangent to the Earth at that point, and this is the vertical at that point. So the coordinates which are natural for that point are this angle, latitude, not that one, that would be the geocentric latitude, this is the geodetic latitude, and then the height is this distance. We can change the height, and all these points have the same latitude, different heights. So that's the correct latitude we need to handle, the one that is defined by the vertical perpendicular to the tangent of the to the ellipsoid at that point. Okay, we have functions. GLDC data is able to convert from, sorry, we go to that case. You can say, I have an angle, a latitude, a geodetic latitude of 47.2 angular degrees. Give me the geocentric latitude, which is this other angle here, the blue one. And you get that. Or you can do it in reverse. I have that geocentric latitude. Give me the geodetic latitude. And we get back the 47.2. Okay, so it's important to remember that we are always working with geodetic latitude. So geoposition takes that, latitude, longitude, and it's geodetic latitude. So, yes, so a datum is a combination of the ellipsoid, we have given these values, and then its position in Spain plus orientation. Those three things form the datum, and that's what we put here. A datum has an ellipsoid, is that one. We can get its values, etc. We have many of them. We have also reference ellipsoids. Remember, the datum is more than an ellipsoid. And I wanted to show how to perform changes of datum. What's happening here is that we start with a geoposition in some datum here. We can convert it into a 3-vector in space. These are the coordinates with respect to this coordinate system of the datum. These are in meters. And now we can ask geodesy data, what are the parameters of the transformation? So we will have three translation in meters, 3 small angles, these are in radians, and this is a change in scale. the result comes in milliard seconds. So we need this factor to change from milliard seconds to radians. And the result of the translation comes in units of 10 to 8. So we need to account for that. So once we have these angles, we perform, this is a rotation matrix, which is just the identity plus the small angles, three. It's an anti-symmetric matrix. So we have that. Then we have this matrix, a rotation. And what is happening here is simply, we take the vector, we rotate it, we rescale it, we translate it. And we get that other vector. If you ask your position XYZ to do that for you, it will give you exactly the same numbers. And then we can come back to latitude and longitude. So see, we changed the datum, and that changed latitude and longitude because each ellipsoid defines different latitude and longitude. There are also transformations which have even information about time because the two datums are moving with respect to each other due to tectonic plates and things like that. Tectonic plates movement. Just in passing, let me point out that a key thing to do fast computations with geopositions is to group them together in a single geoposition. So for example, geoposition of Paris will give this pair. But if you're going to work with lots of geopositions, it's much better to have all of them as an array inside a single geoposition head. For example, if you want to do a change to Mercator coordinates, for example, you see, you can change all of them, the 1,000 points, very quickly at the same time. If you can thread the geoposition, and now you have a list of geopositions there. You can go back by saying, give me the geoposition of this list of geopositions. So this list is lots of geopositions, one by one. And now, for example, if you try to do the same change to Mercator by mapping, you see it's half a second instead of 3 milliseconds. So it's always much faster if you can handle things in a single object. Same thing happens, for example, when you extract latitude and longitude. This is just a matter of putting the thing in a quantity array. It's almost immediate. While if you map this function, well, it gets like 100 times slower. Same thing when you call geo-elevation data. You can call geo-elevation data with lots of points at the same time. If you put it all of them in a single geoposition. This is a single call to the geo server. This is an example that was posted in Mathematical Stack Exchange recently. So the user was given, this polygon in this, these numbers are not clear which coordinates they are. So we need to know the projection that was used. The user was providing these numbers with values of grid origin, centering, etc. And when he plotted this in geographics, there was this result. And this is not quite correct because that should be there and this should be there. What was happening is that there was also a change of datum here. So the user had its original datums in the Amersfoort datum. So there is also a transformation that requires what we did just before, translation, rotation, scale. Now we take that into account and we pass to geogrid position the information that we are also changing the datum. You see, now we get the blue line, which is perfectly positioned. Compare, no? So the change is relatively small, but for applications, it's very important to get it right. Now, something we are going to add soon is this table of EPSG data, which is a table with thousands of parameters about datums and ellipsoids and other things. This is coming soon. I mean, I have it in this. And this will be able to say, oh, I need the operator, this is the operation, this is their code. And now from here, you can get all these numbers. And they provide even, for example, the region in which you should be using these changes, etc. And this was the centering of the projection before. So you see that it matches correctly. OK, I'm going to running out of time. So I wanted to explain how geodistance works. And this is just a bit of complicated bit of ellipsoidal geometry. The ideas are taken from a paper by Carney. And the idea is doing spherical geometry, or the equivalent of spherical geometry, but on the ellipsoid. So you always have triangles, you give three of the numbers, either sides of angles, and you need to compute the other three. And there is a very important fact here, simplifying the fact, which is the axis symmetry. There is an integration constant, and because the geodesic condition is differential, and then this can be converted into quadratures. But the quadratures are still very complicated elliptic integrals. So we have to use series expansions and things like that. There are two basic problems, the direct problems and the inverse problem. The direct problem is I give you the point A and a distance and a direction, and you have to compute B. And the inverse problems is I give you A and B, and you have to give me the distance and the angles alpha 1 and alpha 2. And this is precisely what our functions geodistance and geodirection do. So we give a point and a distance, and it computes the other point, or we can give both points, and we can compute the so-called geodisplacement, which gives you the distance between them and the angle that you have to start with originally to get to the second point. Geoarea is computed similarly, so we have to provide, for example, this is a field curve in which we have the outer geopath and the inner geopath, in this case a geocircle, and what we do is simply computing via integral formulas as well the area under any of these geopaths. So we can compute the area of the field curve, which is that, which is the just subtracting the geo area of the outer one and the inner one. That simple. A comparison with travel directions. This is a case in which we want to travel from Lisbon to there. And this is the result of travel directions. That would be the geodesic, which is supposed to be the shortest curve. Doesn't look like in this map, but this is the fault of the projection again. If we use another projection, which is more adapted, we see that this is almost straight, and this is longer. So that's an example of comparing geodistance travel distance and geodistance. As another example, here we have how to go from one museum to another one in New York. And you can do it driving or walking. And you see how this case knows that it can go through Hyde Park, so you get something shorter. Okay, so now I'm going to embarrass myself by showing two things that were super horrible in version 10, like this, and because it was not able to go around the Earth. This is an example that Brett sent me at some point. And now we can do it better. So this is because now there is a very fast algorithm that internally that clips the primitives, taking into account longitude periodicity, and so it gets these things better. There is another one, also based in clipping, which is this another algorithm taking into account which lines shouldn't be crossing from side to side. So here I have some code that randomly chooses a projection, a centering, and any number of lines, and hopefully we'll not see any crazy thing happening, including complicated cases like this. And I had a few more slides on geophysics, but I think I'm going to stop here. You will have the access to this notebook. And here I was just explaining how the geophysics function that Jason introduced work. So geogravity model data, geomagnetic model data, and geoelevation data, in which we have added recently the geoid information for elevation.
Jason, stop us tomorrow.
Sorry?
Jason, stop us tomorrow.
Okay. And well, my last slide, these are the future projects. And as I said, new projection types, EPSG data, geodistortion functions. We want to add algorithms that work locally instead of having to go frequently to the GeoServer to do computations. Then incorporate elevation into all of that, including vertical datums, and continue improving the functionality of geographics. Thank you very much.